The following is a local resident producers program. The program content is the sole responsibility of the producer and does not necessarily reflect the views or policies of Oshkosh Media, the City of Oshkosh, or Time Warner Cable.
Hi everybody, welcome to another edition of Eye on Oshkosh. I'm your host Cheryl Hentz, and this is our first episode of 2017, so Happy New Year to you. I'm very grateful to our guests this evening for braving the extreme cold and wind chills of well into the negatives to be here. John Zarate, am I pronouncing that correctly?
You are.
Okay. John Zarate is the chief building official for the Inspection Services Division here in the City of Oshkosh, and I wanted him to come in because there are so many questions that people have, I think just about building permits in general, and certainly with this rental inspection ordinance that's effective as of January 1st. So we wanted to get a lot of information out to you folks about all the stuff that John's department with Inspection Services does. So in the next 58 minutes or so, we're going to be covering an awful lot of information. So you may want to have a pen and paper handy to take down some things or catch this on a replay, or if you're watching it on YouTube, you can always go back and find the exact spot that we're, you know, talking about something that you're interested in. So anyway, welcome. Thanks for being here.
Sure. You're welcome. Thanks for having me and inviting
me to the show. Hope your holidays were good, and now we've got this Arctic temperature, this deep freeze that we're in, and I wonder, why do people live here?
Well, I don't mind it most of the time because I am an avid snowmobiler, so I do like to get out and do some of that, but now it's a little bit too cold to do that, and most of the snow is now gone because of the warmer temperatures we had right before that.
Yep, we did. This winter has been so weird already, the fall and then going into the winter, but hopefully you'll still have plenty of time to snowmobile.
Oh, yeah.
So tell us a little bit about yourself. You've actually been with the city for longer than I had even thought.
Okay.
You were just telling me that you've been here since 2002.
Right, yeah. So I started
I
started with the City of Oshkosh in 2002 as a building inspector. Prior to that, I was working as a building inspector, kind of a regional coordinator for a private inspection company out of Waukesha. I was kind of covering the northeast part of Wisconsin. I had been with them for about 10 years prior to coming to the City of Oshkosh. During my time with the City of Oshkosh, I was a building inspector up until about the last, about 5 years. And then I was applied for the supervisor position that was open, and I'm now the chief building official, so supervisor of that division in Oshkosh.
And so what specifically do you do in your position, and what does the Inspection Services Department do as a whole?
Okay. So pretty much what I do is supervise the entire division. Because we're running on kind of a lean focus on do more with less, I'm also involved in a lot of the day-to-day stuff, so issuing permits, doing plan reviews, doing inspections, answering phone calls, answering emails from the general public. So I still do all that. And then in addition, like I said, I supervise all of my staff. In Inspection Services, we now kind of have almost three divisions in one. Last year, we took on the Weights and Measures Program, which the city used to do. That's the duties of what they would call the city sealer. That person is responsible for going to local businesses to make sure that all of their measuring devices are correct.
Like a gas station.
Grocery stores with scales, department stores with price scanners, and just to make sure that all of those items are correct, you know, car washes that have dryers to make sure you're getting the proper time, laundromats to make sure that, you know, if you're paying a quarter for 10 minutes, you're getting the 10 minutes of time in the dryer.
Wow, that alone is a huge responsibility.
Right.
How large of a staff do you have?
Actually, for that, we have one person that does that. So
just one person?
One person does that, right. And he's quite busy with that.
I bet he is.
Yeah. Hopefully the weather will warm up for him this spring and we can get going on some of the gas pumps. Prior to us doing this last, starting this last year, we had his contract with the state of Wisconsin. Prior to the merger of the health department, that Weights and Measures Division was under the City Health Department.
Okay.
When the city merged, or when the county took over the Health Department, then the Weights and Measures part of that went to the state under contract.
Okay.
We didn't have the staff to do it. So we decided there were some inefficiencies with the program that we were seeing, and so we decided to see if we could hire on staff and do it ourselves. And so we had a really successful first year with that. Had some education to do with some of the businesses that hadn't been visited in quite some time. And I think we're really picking up, and the gentleman we have doing that now, Kurt, is doing a great job. He's gone through a lot of training with the state of Wisconsin. He's passed all of his tests that he needs to be a licensed city sealer. So that's doing very good for him, and as a matter of fact, we are working right now with the City of Neenah to help them out with some of their weights and measures.
Wow.
Yeah, and we'll be contracted out with the City of Neenah with any luck.
Okay. And so I had a problem one time with a gas pump, you know, where I just didn't think that it was calculating things. It had one posted price, but it seemed to be running at a different price, and so I know that I called, and I don't know what the outcome really was, but I know that your department, or maybe it probably was under the health department at that time, because this was a few years ago, but it was taken care of, and they did call to let me know it was taken care of. Was 2016 then your first year doing this?
2016 was the first year taking that back over, so that
okay.
was the first year that it was under me. Prior to that, the only thing I was supervising was basically the state contract.
Okay, all right. Boy, I just can't get over that you even go in and check price scanners. I mean, that's a good thing,
right.
You know, from a consumer standpoint,
yeah.
But that's just when you think of all the stores that just use price scanners,
right.
You know,
right.
That just seems like a monumental
yeah.
thing.
And, you know, depending on the size of the store and how many scanners they have, depends on how many items we have to scan at
sure.
each one of those stores. So if it's a big store, you know, you may be scanning 100 items
mm-hmm.
and making sure that all those prices are correct. That and verifying the prices on the shelves are right, you know, they all match what
wow.
ends up at the scanner. So, you know, and I think it's not only for the customer, it's also for the business.
Sure.
You know, if they think that they're, you know, charging, you know, they're selling a pound of stuff, and maybe it's not, maybe they're giving away some of the product.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they think they're charging for a pound, and they're actually giving a pound and a quarter or something like that.
Sure.
So, you know, it helps the businesses, too, just to make sure everyone's getting what they're paying for.
Sure. And that is a very good point, because that's going to lead us into one of the bigger items that I wanted to chat with you about tonight, and that is, and this has gotten a lot of press in the last several months, Oshkosh has started a rental inspection program, if you will. There is a city ordinance in place now, and it took effect, you started with this the first of the year, so you probably haven't gotten too far into this yet. But it's a program under which, and an ordinance under which, rental properties in the city have to be inspected once every 5 years?
Correct.
Okay. And that has just been met with a lot of negative comments, you know, landlords just, in some cases, being up in arms over this, threats of lawsuits and so forth. So there are some things that John won't be able to share with us tonight, and I certainly respect that, and I hope that as a viewer, or if you're listening to this on the radio, as a listener, that you understand that there are some things we can't get into. But the reason that I say that's a good segue for us is because that program I think, benefits landlords as well as tenants in
right.
that if there's a problem that an inspector finds, it could potentially have been a problem that would lead someone to sue that landlord if there was an accident or an incident of some kind. And so it is a protection for both the tenants and the landlords, and I think that's how landlords and property owners should kind of look at this too, even though it's costing them money. So let's talk about every property is going to be inspected every 5 years, and what's the cost to the property owner?
And just to clarify, it wouldn't be every property in the city of Oshkosh, it's only the
rental properties
where someone lives. And it's
right.
not any businesses. We've had a lot of confusion
right.
where someone is calling us, you know, from one of the stores and saying, well, when are you going to come and inspect my store for this rental thing? Well, we're not inspecting stores. It's if someone lives there and they're renting, that's what we're inspecting.
It's residences,
right.
not businesses, and it's only rental properties.
Right.
So if you are a tenant, for example, this is one thing I found out when I had the city manager on the show, is that tenants can actually call and ask that their property be inspected.
Right.
It doesn't have to be that the landlord
initiates.
It doesn't
have to be part of the program as well. You're right. So for many years in the city, I would say probably at least 30 years, we've always had a complaint-based inspection program. We have a full-time housing inspector. He will respond to all the rental complaints that we get. So if the landlord is not following through with fixing what the tenant's claiming is wrong, the inspector goes out there to check those things out and to verify if there are any violations. If there are any violations, then the landlord is let known about those and is told to correct them. And really what we're looking for out there is all health and safety items. So you know, there's rumors out there, all kinds of rumors of different stuff that we're going to be looking for. And I think it's just to get the people to turn on the inspectors in the city to make us look like the bad guys. And, you know, they're saying that we're going to be looking for drug paraphernalia and stolen street signs and, you know, felons and stuff like that. And that's far, far from what we're looking for. We're looking for the health and safety things in these places, you know. We want to make sure that people have deadbolts. We want to make sure people have proper heat. We want to make sure that their appliances are properly vented when they're gas appliances so there isn't carbon monoxide leaking out into the buildings. That the windows open and close. Those types of things. Make sure they don't have leaky plumbing. Make sure there isn't wires that are open in the basement that could be ready to cause a fire. Those types of things are what we're looking for.
Okay. And so it costs how much?
So what we have done is we're calling it basically like a $100 trip charge and $45 a unit. So
okay.
for a single family rental, for a single family home, it would be $145.
Okay.
And then for a duplex, just to give those two examples, it would be the
$190. Okay.
And if we were to go to a multi-unit, then it would just be the $45 times however many units plus the $100 trip
okay.
charge.
Well, that's certainly fair. Now, what if you have to say it's a 16 unit place or larger? You can't get to everything in one trip.
Mm-hmm.
Then do they get charged a second trip charge?
They would get charged. You're right.
Okay.
Correct. Yeah.
All right.
Yeah. And so you know, this program really evolved from where we thought it was going to go, and that was. In large part because of the state of Wisconsin changing the rules on us as we were developing this. So we had initially planned a certain section of the city and probably to also hit up on some of the landlords that we had previous problems with and just start there with this program and sort of like a pilot area.
Mm-hmm.
Once the landlords caught wind of that, they kind of went to the state and said, if we have to do it, everyone should have to do it.
Mm-hmm.
And so the state changed the rules and said, yeah, that's the way it's got to be. And so now everyone has to do it. And so we went from thinking that we were maybe going to have 2,000 inspections to 13,000 inspections. Some of those inspections will probably, most of those inspections will probably result in no violations found. I mean, that means we have to inspect the brand new buildings that were just built along the river. And I mean,
even though you had an inspector inspecting them
right.
as part of the building process?
Right. Yeah, because that was the building inspection as they're doing construction. So now this would be the rental inspection program. In order for us to be uniform and consistent
sure.
And avoid any other lawsuits that might crop up on us, we have to do everyone.
So. Wow. Well, that's good, and yet if I had just built something brand new, I'm not sure how I'd feel about that.
Right. But and so now that the program's implemented, you know, what we'll do is we'll discount that rental inspection program when we do the final inspection for the building. But because those buildings were just inspected right at the end of last year, I think it was in fall, that doesn't count because the rental inspection program wasn't in place at that time.
But since every place is only going to get inspected every 5 years, couldn't you make those on the back end of this?
Yeah, we could try to do that. We've tried to lay out a map and kind of give like a 5 years areas that we're going to do every year. And so we're starting with the central city would be the first.
Okay.
There's a map on the city's website that would show different areas of the city that we're going to do. But primarily it's going to be central city first, and then in year five it would be out everything west of Highway 41.
Okay.
So kind of goes north and south of that, and then east is, I mean, but it's kind of the way it breaks down. So we don't kind of jump all over the city. We are trying to do one clump of the city.
Sure.
So kind of the same
area. And you know, the central city area is where the bulk of the older homes are.
Right.
It's mostly old housing stock. I mean, there are some new things in the city, like along Division and places like that. But I mean, for the most part, we're talking older housing stock.
Right.
And a lot of rental properties because they're so close in proximity to the university.
Right.
So, so that's, you know, I guess a good place to start. And so, what can someone expect when an inspector comes in, and how many inspectors are going to be working on this program?
So what we'll do is we planned it when we get it at full staff, we will have 3 full-time inspectors to run the program. Initially what we're going to do is start with 1 inspector, and then as we work into this, you know, bring another inspector on, train that inspector. After he's trained, bring on the second and then the third, and then we would be at full staff. So it'll take us a little while to ramp up, but it's just kind of getting a feel for the program and how that's going to work. So on the premise, you're typically just going to see the 1 inspector, unless you happen to hit one of the training sessions. Then, you know, if that's maybe 1 month for the one guy, you might have 2 inspectors there.
Okay.
But, you know, we're going to be notifying the tenants. The law said that we are not able to have the landlords require the landlords to contact us to set the inspection. We have to do that with the tenants. So we'll be sending out letters to the tenants, giving them kind of say, hey, in the next 30 days, we'd like to do an inspection of your rental property. Please give us a call. We do let them know that it is a voluntary inspection. It's entirely up to them if they want us to be inside of their place or not. If not, we will inspect the outside. If there were some sort of adverse conditions on the outside, broken windows, really bad roof, something that looks like maybe the house is going to fall or the occupants inside could be in risk of health or safety items, then we may do a special process involving a court order to allow us into that house just because we see something from the outside that looks like there could be a potential life safety hazard in that house. For the most part, I mean, if they don't want us in, we're not going to go in.
Really? So even though it's an ordinance, and which means it's a local law.
Right.
So, but it still is on a voluntary basis.
Right. Yeah. So they have to have a right to who they allow into their house.
Mm-hmm.
And if they decide they don't want us in, then we're not going in.
Wow, that's kind of surprising to me.
Right. And so I mean, I think that was kind of the misconception too. You know, that's out there where your home, you know, you see these signs around town where your homes will be searched. The city's going to violate your rights. No, we're not. You know, and the only time if you would consider it violating your rights is if we see something from the outside of the home on a house that we weren't allowed into that looks like, for whatever reason, the occupant could be at risk of danger, we're not going in. We're not going to go to the judge because the judge isn't going to allow us in. They need evidence as to why they think it's so important for us to get into a building.
So, realistically, in the 5 years' time, you guys may not be getting to anywhere near the 13,000 rental units that there are in the city.
Right, that could be. So, you know, we just kind of took a shot in the dark on what we kind of thought based on our complaint-based inspections that we do now and how long those take and how much staff time it takes to do those inspections. And we laid that out over the 5 years with three full-time staff people and said, okay, well, I think this is how long it'll take to get through the city, 5 years with three full-time people.
Mm-hmm.
If it's less than that, you know, if we're finding people that aren't letting us in, yeah, it's going to take far less time to do that mm-hmm. inspection. We would hope that the tenants would let us in. Like I said, we're not there to look to see if their place is, you know, clean or if they're underage and they're drinking or something they shouldn't be or whatever else the rumors are. I mean, we're there to make sure that these people have a safe place. We have heard time and time again that tenants are afraid of landlords.
Yes.
They don't want to call for whatever reason. The main reason is they're fearful that the landlord's going to kick them out.
Mm-hmm.
They're fearful the landlords are going to raise their rent. So this proactive inspection would be, well, the tenant didn't even call, so it wasn't their fault that we came in. It's because you own rental, you know, it's a rental property. We're going in. The tenants allowed us in. This was nothing on the tenant, you know. I had a call the other day from a concerned parent of one of the college students that said, you know, our landlord just said there's this new program, and when the city sends you the notice, you need to deny access to the inspector. Do not let them in under any circumstance. If you do, you're going to pay for the inspection, and you're going to pay for any repairs I have to make. And, and that's the bully tactics that these tenants are afraid of. That's what we're hoping this program will help with, is some of that type of thing.
Sure. Well, and you know, I mean, I think that by and large, I think for the most part, landlords are decent people, but I think there is a segment of landlords that just really want to make the money, but they don't want to necessarily do everything that's involved. And I'm not going to mention any names. I know you won't either, but and then there's some landlords that just simply don't know what the laws really are. You know, they think,
right.
Oh, well, this is a way to make a little extra money. Rarely is someone who owns one or two properties getting rich off this.
Right.
I mean, it usually just kind of balances out,
mm-hmm.
But you're not making money necessarily. You're paying down your your mortgage and building up a little equity,
right.
But at no real cost to you, but you're not making a ton of money.
Right.
But little things like windows on the ground level have to have screens.
Right.
And that's, I mean, is that true of all homes or just rental properties?
In our ordinance, it's only true in the rental properties.
Okay.
It's the only, you know, there isn't a requirement in the state code that says your windows have to have screens on them.
Okay.
So a lot of our rental codes, I shouldn't say a lot, but there are things in the rental code in Oshkosh that don't apply to an owner-occupied home.
Okay.
So you're not forced to have a deadbolt on your personal home. That, I guess, came around when there was some a lot of break-ins or whatever in the college area, I think is how that rule I had heard come up many, many years ago prior to me being at the city. And
okay.
So at the time, then they said, well, this is what we're going to put in the ordinance then, deadbolts on every exterior door.
Okay, so that's a rule for rental properties, and is that too just for ones that are like single standalone properties, or if you live in a building and you're say on the second or third floor, you still have to have a deadbolt?
Right.
Okay.
Yep. So it would be any of the buildings that have doors. So any of the main hallways would have to have a deadbolt on the doors.
Okay. All right. So that's something that I didn't know either. So that's a good thing. The other thing that I think a lot of landlords don't know is there's actually a state code, which you guys follow state codes, that talks about how warm a resident
yep.
must be.
Yep, that was another example I was going to give.
You know, I mean, the state law, at least when I was a landlord for 20-some years, state law says that you must be able to stand in the middle of a room and the temperature must read 68 degrees. And if it doesn't register that, then there's a heating issue.
Right.
And, you know, a lot of tenants have, I mean, this is extreme cold weather, but even in just a typical winter, a lot of tenants complain about my property's cold, my unit's cold, my house is cold, whatever it is that they're renting, but their landlords don't want to do anything about it.
Mm-hmm.
So when you guys go in, are you actually taking a temperature gauge or
yeah.
a thermometer or something?
We'll definitely do that. And, you know, especially on the ones, you know obviously, you know, we walk in an apartment and it's like, whoa, it's cold in here.
Mm-hmm.
We're probably going to question it. You know, do you have your thermostat set? Do you like it cold in here? What is the reason for it? You know, if they got the thermostat cranked up, you know, 80 degrees and it feels cold in there, we're probably going to question it and say, all right, well, yeah, they said it doesn't get warm in here. All right, well, it's improper heat.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and there are some standards. You know, you mentioned the bitter cold. I forget what the cutoff is, but there is a certain temperature, and I can't remember if it's zero or if it's 10 below where your house has to meet that temperature. So if it's 20 below, you don't have to meet that 68. I think there's a trade-off then that they realize that it's so cold that for whatever reason the
furnace can't keep up.
You'll never warm up. Right. But for the most part, you know, you're right on with that. But whatever reason they don't want to provide heat, and that's one of the minimums. And I guess that was where I was going to, my example of what is different in a single family house. If you choose to not heat your house, or if your furnace can't keep up and 63 degrees, you live with it. I can't make you as a building inspector turn the heat up in your house or fix your furnace to make it warmer for you.
Right, right. Yeah, but a tenant who's paying money to rent there shouldn't have to shiver,
right.
Shouldn't have to wear several layers of blankets or
right.
comforters, or sit watching television at night with a coat on, a hat, and
right.
mittens.
You're exactly
you know?
Right. Yep.
You know, you're paying money for a decent place to live, and it doesn't have to be the Taj Mahal, but you have to have basic certain things,
right.
and one of those is decent heat.
Right.
You know, so I guess it's probably advisable then that if a tenant is concerned about their property, they should just call the city
right.
and request an inspection
yeah.
If they're concerned about anything.
Yeah. At any time. I mean, if even outside of the program, like I said earlier, we have the program already in place. We've had it for several years, complaint based. If you have a problem and you're a tenant, call us. We'll come over there and address any problem that you think you have. You know, if it's not in our jurisdiction, you know, someone will say, you know, it's too loud in my apartment. You know, the tenants next door are too loud. Well, that's not us. You know, maybe it's a police issue. Maybe it's
right.
disturbing the peace. That's not us. You know, if there's something, you know, I don't like the color of my curtains. Well, there's nothing in our code that says we have to enforce the color of your curtains.
Mm-hmm.
you know, if they say, I've got a leak under my sink, the landlord says, I've got to change the bucket every day, you know, and my heat doesn't work, and my door doesn't shut right. Okay, those are things we need to know about.
Okay.
You know.
What about, and I'm going to get real specific on this one, John, what about mold that someone may have in their basement in particular? And the reason I'm asking this is because a family member in the Milwaukee area called because a place had mold in the basement. And I followed up on that call with them. And they actually have a mold department there or whatever. They deal in mold and lead. And I was actually told by someone in the city of Milwaukee that they don't care if there's mold, because mold spores happen anywhere, and mold can be a good thing. And
right.
I'm like, what?
Right. So they're right. And you know, as much as the media makes it out to be, you know, the media is out there to get the people to watch them and to make a big story. And so the media has really blown up mold over the last, say, 10 years. And as an inspector, I always say to people, if it's such a big issue, why is it not in my code? And so, and like you said, in our code, there is nothing I can do for mold. And we'll get that complaint often that, oh, there's mold on the windows, there's mold under my cabinets, there's mold in my bathtub, there's mold in my basement. Okay, there's nothing I can do about the mold, but you said there's mold in your basement. Why is there mold in your basement? Are the walls leaking? You know, is your roof leaking? Why is there mold in this room? You know, is something leaking in the bathroom? Is the exhaust fan not working? Those types of things. Okay, so if you have mold because of that, let's get rid of the mold. I don't care if you do or if you don't, but let's get rid of the problem that's creating the mold.
Mm-hmm.
That we can work with. So we'll get the roof fixed. We'll get the basement walls fixed.
So seriously, there is nothing in a code anywhere.
There's nothing that we can in a new home. There's nothing that we can do on a rental property. And you would think that the way the media has blown this up and everyone worries about it, and they've got a lot of people worried about it because they think that's their out. There's mold in my house. You know, I want to get out of here. It's like,
well, and you've got doctors, you know, medical
right.
facilities saying mold is not a good thing.
Right.
And so I think that's where the media is probably picking up on some of this stuff. I know I have in the past,
mm-hmm.
as someone who worked in the media and in some ways still does. You know, And yet there's nothing that can be done. I mean, literally, so this is kind of surprising to me. I thought maybe it was just someone in the city of Milwaukee just spewing this out to me. And I just thought, this is unreal. I don't think that would ever fly in Oshkosh, but now I'm finding out it would because there's nothing.
Yeah, right. Like I said, so yeah, there's nothing we can do with mold. I mean, they could have the place covered in mold. What we will do, like I said, if there's something where there's some sort of water leaking in from the outside and that's what's causing the mold, okay, we're going to make them stop the leak. You know, clean up the mold, that's probably the right thing to do. We can't force them to do that.
So you'll get to the source or try to get to the source of what's creating the mold.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
And that you can, depending on what it is, perhaps do something about.
Right.
Okay. Wow. Well, I'm going to have to process this for a while, John. This is an interesting one to me. You know, how did the city come about this inspection, this rental property inspection program? Other cities must have it.
Right. So, yeah, there were other cities that have it. We did kind of model ours off of what Wausau had created. We had talked with the inspectors there. We did a, I don't want to call it a tour, but we met with some of the staff up in La Crosse that had a program as well. But how it came about was they were seeing a large turnover in the older area where people were selling their homes and they were becoming rentals. And so as that happened, you know, maybe the rentals for whatever reason aren't taken care of, kids park all over the lawns, they trash the place, people don't want to live next door to them. Okay, how do we stop this from eroding the city, you know, and making this all run down, decreasing property values? And then how do we provide a safe place for kids to live or anyone, not only kids, but, you know, that was our first thing was kind of the college area, but now it's anyone. And, you know, how do we give anyone a safe place to rent who may not know any better or who does, but they're afraid of their landlord? And so we talked to the people at La Crosse and Wausau and really liked their program, met with their inspectors, and that's something we said, you know, this, we think this is what would help in Oshkosh. You know, some of the goals that the city council had set for us, you know, to make Oshkosh beautiful or whatever the slogan was or whatever they were looking to do, you know, what do you think would help bring our neighborhoods back together or make our neighborhoods better? Well, this is what we thought would help. And so they pushed for the rental inspection program and then passed the ordinance after we had worked with all the laws that we had to follow on how to make all of the thing comply with the law after the state changed the law on us. And with that, the program is now, we believe, under this what state statutes allows, and hopefully if we are now that we've implemented the program, we start doing the program, this will improve the rental property and also some of the neighborhoods that contain the rental property.
Sure. How long has the city of Wausau had their program?
I believe they've only had theirs for about a year or two.
Okay.
La Crosse, I would say over 10. Pretty much every UW city in Wisconsin has or had some sort of rental inspection program.
Okay.
Because they had problems. There were other cities that are outside of the UW cities that had them as well. But most we had found of the bigger UW cities had some sort of rental program, whether it was just the campus area or what have you, but they had a rental program.
And has it worked well to accomplish what the goals were in those cities?
Right, yeah, because they had, you know, like our model that in La Crosse, you know, they said, you know, our first year was, you know, we found so many violations, it was an education. And so, okay, we told everyone, here's what you have to fix. And when they went back the next year, 2 years or whatever their cycle was in La Crosse, well, now it was better. You know, they didn't have any, maybe they didn't have any violations, maybe they only had one violation. So it was like, okay, they went from 10 to 1 in a property. Look, that's great. You know, the landlords got educated, the city helped out, and now things are moving along a lot smoother. La Crosse has suspended theirs just because they didn't have the correct ordinance in place with the state statute. So I think they're just kind of, right now I think it's all eyes on Oshkosh across the whole state of Wisconsin to see how this goes. And to see if it does go.
And no pun intended when you say eyes on Oshkosh.
Right.
But I like the slogan, eye on Oshkosh. walk me through a typical inspection, John. You walk in, you say, hi, I'm so-and-so. Oh, sure, come on in.
Right.
And then where do you go first? What do you look at?
So we'll just start in the main, you know, wherever we're entering in. As we're entering in the living room, we'll look around and, you know, we'll do we see, we're looking around and okay, well now I'm looking at this light fixture and it looks like this light fixture is hanging out with some cords hanging out of it. That's a violation. We've got open wiring. Okay, now I'm looking around and that window's broken and it's boarded up, or there's no screen on the window. That's going to be a violation. Okay, now we're done there. Let's move down maybe into the bathroom. Okay, well, why is the sink constantly dripping? Oh, it always drips. There's no way to turn it off. Well, that's a violation. You know, maybe we move into the kitchen and I don't know what the problem would be in the kitchen, but maybe their outlet, every time they stick something in the outlet, they get sparks out of the outlet. Okay, that's not a good thing. That's a violation. We move around the apartment, depending on how many bedrooms they have. We check those things out. We're always going to check the smoke detectors. That's the number one, first thing we always check, pretty much, is we're going to go for the smoke detectors. Scary enough is that's probably our biggest violation on every complaint-based inspection we've done, is the smoke detectors aren't functional or aren't there.
Mm-hmm.
So definitely smoke detectors, we're going to check to make sure that those are one on each floor. So if they've got two stories, you know, we're looking for one on both of those and then one in the basement. Basement, we're looking for things that are properly connected for venting. If they've got gas appliances, a gas furnace, we want to make sure that that's properly vented to the outside. We've seen pictures of very weird things and dangerous situations of how things are vented. Dryers aren't vented to the outside, so the dryer lint is just all blowing around in the basement, things like that. And then again, you get into open wire, and maybe you've got a leak in the wall or something, and there's pounding of water down in the basement. You know, that's a violation. You can't be having that. So, and that's kind of your typical. It's very, very general. We do have a checklist. It's very basic, and all of them are kind of like a life safety issue. I mean, it's not, yeah, okay, the paint's peeling a little bit. That's not a violation. A big hole in the wall, that's a problem.
Okay. Yeah, well, you know, if I had noticed a hole in one of my walls, I would have been on my tenants about, hey, what happened here?
Right.
You know. What about you talked about smoke detectors. What about CO detectors?
Yes, and those are also required. Yep,
okay.
Yep.
One on each, in each unit, or one on each floor?
One on each floor.
Okay.
And if you're, I guess, lucky enough, if you want to say that, to have like all electric appliances, nothing that produces CO, then you don't have to have the CO detector. And we do have some of those units where there are no gas appliances, then there would be a need for it, because there's no way you're going to have CO poisoning with no gas appliances.
Okay, all right. So smoke detectors, one on each floor, and if you have any gas appliances, a smoke a CO detector on each floor.
Correct.
Okay, and deadbolts on each door.
Exterior door. So if it's a house, you know, and they have a front and a back door, it has to be on both of those.
Okay.
If you're an apartment in a complex and you have a main hallway, it would be to that main door leading out to the hallway.
Okay. All right, good. You know, this whole business of smoke detectors, I think that a lot of people kind of get confused on that. And I always caution my tenants. I said, you know, don't be taking the batteries out of these detectors. They're here to protect you. Don't be taking the batteries out. If it's chirping, call me. And I would actually have them sign not just a thing from the state of Wisconsin, but from the city of Oshkosh also, that says, look, I understand that maintaining the smoke detector is your responsibility as a landlord, but I also understand it's my responsibility as a tenant to let my landlord know. So I don't have to pay for the batteries to be replaced. That's on the landlord, but it's my responsibility to keep batteries in there and not disconnect the unit. You know, a lot of times you'd get college students, and I don't want to beat up on college students, but they would be the ones who frequently would disconnect the smoke detectors.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't always know that. You know, you don't come in every day to check to make sure that the
right
smoke detector's there, and you don't always know that. And I mean, I didn't have a huge problem with that, but I have talked to landlords who that has been a big complaint of theirs too. You know, these so-and-so tenants just keep taking them off the walls or
right
off the ceilings and taking the batteries out. But again, so if you're a tenant, it's your responsibility to A, keep the smoke detectors in place, and B, test them regularly. And if they're not working right, it's your responsibility to let your landlord know. And it's the landlord's responsibility to take care of those things.
Right, and you had a good point about having them, the tenants, sign a form that, you know, when they move in, kind of their move-in form. Smoke detectors are working, they're operational, the batteries are in them. You have the whole clause, I will tell the landlord when the batteries go low. The landlord will give me batteries every 6 months or every year to replace in the smoke detector. They understand that, they sign that. You know, that's something that we'll look for as an inspector. If we come in and there's no smoke detectors, the tenant says, well, there was never any smoke detectors. Okay, now the landlord comes with the piece of paper that you were talking about and their signatures on it. The tenant's getting the citation, not the landlord.
Interesting.
Yeah, so okay, that's one of the ones that we can put on the tenant. That is the smoke detector. That's a very serious offense. And that one I won't accept any excuses for. And so, you know, I've had one recently where I went in and there was a two-story house, single-family house, and there wasn't a smoke detector in the place. And, you know, I asked her, I said, where are the smoke detectors? Were they here when you moved in? There wasn't any smoke detectors when she moved in. No. I could see where they were supposed to be, but they weren't there. Mm-hmm. The landlord didn't deny it, so.
Interesting. I remember many years ago, around this time of year, there was a fire in a, I don't know if it was actually student inhabited, but it was in the college area. And I can't remember if the smoke detectors, I think they were there, but they weren't working. And I believe everybody in the house perished in the fire. And it's just, I mean, smoke detectors are so inexpensive, and they're so easy to put in. Even I could do that.
Right.
I mean, who can't turn a screwdriver,
right,
you know, and put them in? And changing batteries is no big deal.
Right.
It's just one of the simplest things that someone can do to fix, and yet it's one of the most important things that they can have.
Yeah, and, you know, they've come out with some advances in smoke detectors now where they have a smoke detector where they claim it's got a 10-year life expectancy, non-removable battery. So you're not going to have the worry. I mean, so if you're a landlord, I guess, and you're worried that your tenants are going to do that and you want to keep them safe, put the smoke detector in that has a 10-year battery, and you can't take the battery out and use it in your remote control or whatever you're going to use the batteries in. So there is that. But, you know, getting back to the deaths, when I check with the fire department and the deaths that we've had in the city in living units have all been rentals.
Yeah. Yeah. And then you have to try and figure out, well, did they let the landlord know that they weren't working? Or did the landlord know and just not care? I don't know. That's why I guess lawyers get paid the kind of money that they get paid to kind of sort those issues out and fight those issues. But it's so important. It's so inexpensive. And there's just, I agree, there's no reason for them not to be there.
Mm-hmm.
And you can hardly even plead ignorance on that one. Because for years, people have talked about the importance of smoke detectors. We all know the importance of them. And it's actually a state law that every property, whether it's rental or not, has a smoke detector on every floor, right?
Correct. Yep, and a CO.
If you have gas appliances.
Yeah.
And in private homes, I think a lot of us have gas appliances.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So we're starting to down to be like our last 15 minutes here. I want to talk about a few other things. But when you are doing these inspections, I know that if someone calls up and says, my neighbor has a couch sitting on their porch, and it's not a closed-in porch, and it's not a couch designed to be outside, can you do something about this? You guys will come out and look at that and take a picture and find the landlord. However, you will also look around. I think someone told me once you'll do like a 360-degree view of everything around that particular property.
Right.
That includes neighboring properties.
Yep.
And if you see something, you'll write up. Are you going to be doing that with this kind of thing also?
No, we're not. That's a great question, and I wanted to make sure that that's very distinguished, that we do not have those combined together. The rental inspection program is going to be the checklist that we give them. These are the things we're looking for. However, if we do see something like a couch on a neighbor's porch or a car parked in someone's yard. That isn't part of our inspection. That isn't getting written up. But we do have a code enforcement inspector, and we'll let them know, hey, there's a violation at this address. You need to go investigate it. They will do that. We don't want this to be part of our program. We're not looking for those things as a violation for this program. It's only the rental inspection checklist. But those are violations, you're right. That is another part of my division that we didn't get into, and that is the code enforcement division. And that is the type of thing that they're looking for. So cars parked on lawns. Indoor furniture that's outside on porches or in the front yard. Long grass. Houses that are in bad repair from the exterior, whether it's rental or owner-occupied. And all of those things apply to rental or owner-occupied. So it's not just, we can't only pick on the renters or the rental properties there. It's everyone in the city.
Right.
So, you know, if you own a house and you park your car in the front lawn, you're just at much of a problem as the guy renting a house. So it's all the same.
And it's only a matter of time before someone calls and says, hey, this, you know, this is degrading my property value.
Right.
You know, I don't, it's an eyesore. I don't want to look at it. I don't want it to be there anymore. And I mean, and you can tell, especially in like when there's not snow on the ground, say from spring to fall, if there are car marks, tire marks
right.
there all the time, you can tell that someone's parking there on a pretty
right.
regular basis and
yep.
shouldn't be.
Right.
So I do want to talk about a few of these other things. So I just want to sum up this landlord, this rental inspection. First of all, if you're a tenant, you know, you can call the city. You can also go to their website and online. You create an account, and it's very easy to go through the steps, and you can request that your property that you're renting be inspected. And, you know, even in that case, the landlord can't be taking, you know, some repercussions out on you for asking that your property be inspected, right?
Legally, I don't believe they can do that.
Right. And hopefully they wouldn't.
Right.
But in a case like this, you're just going to be coming around anyway,
right.
Asking. So, you know, if you feel that there's a problem, ask the city for your help. They can be a good friend to you. So don't feel like you shouldn't be contacting them. What if you find something that is just inherently wrong and yet very expensive to fix? Does the city work with landlords in a case like that?
Yep.
Do you have a program where the city can loan them the money, sort of?
Yeah, both of those. And so, you know, depending on how big the problem is, you know, maybe they've got some really, really, you know, and this wouldn't be the rental program, but serious peeling paint in a house. Okay, well, they're going to probably need more than 5 days to fix that. Well, could we have 2 months? I guess that's reasonable. You know, this time of the year, we're not going to tell them you got to get your house painted. Okay, let's give you till June, because by the time the weather warms up, it might be until June before you can start painting. You know, maybe there's I can't. Maybe a new roof. You know, we got to get someone lined up. That's going to take us 2 months. We've got the contract. He says he can come in a month. Okay, we're going to do that. As long as they're working with us towards compliance, that's what we want to see. You know, we aren't out there to give tickets. We're out there to get compliance.
Mm-hmm.
The only time we're issuing a citation is when the landlords have stopped working with us or have never chosen to work with us, or the homeowners don't work with us.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when we can't get compliance, then the only thing we can do is to issue a citation. So we'll give them a notice, and depending on the severity of the violation, determines how many days it is. You know, smoke detectors, those are immediate. Those have to be replaced that day. You know,
mm-hmm.
basically, I don't want to leave until that smoke detector is there.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we'll come back later, but the smoke detector's got to be there.
Yeah.
You know, and then there's things that are easy to fix. You know, a car parked in the yard. That better be gone that day, but we're going to check in 5 days. So again, we're giving them almost 5 days, not to say that parking there every day after we tell them is legal. It's not, but we're giving them 5 days to do it. If you tell me you need a month to move it, no one needs a month to move the car off the lawn.
Right. That takes 30 seconds.
Right. As long as it starts, I guess.
And that doesn't necessarily mean just moving it a foot one day and another foot the next day
right.
until it's off the property.
Yeah.
Let's talk about building permits, because I think that's one thing, John, that many people are so misunderstood about. You know, even putting in a hot water heater, unless you're putting it in by yourself, you're supposed to be getting a permit, right?
Yourself. So, you know, it's almost kind of a joke of what I would tell someone, but it's almost, it has a lot of truth to it. I pretty much tell someone, unless you're doing something other than painting or recarpeting your house, call us because it probably needs a permit. Water heater replacement does. Toilet replacement does. You know, if you're going to change out your faucet on your sink, no, we don't need the permit for just changing out the faucet.
So what's the reasoning behind, I guess I can see the reasoning behind a hot water heater because you're using gas.
Mm-hmm. Or electric.
Or electric. What's the reasoning behind a toilet? If somebody, say they whatever reason, the toilet bowl cracks or whatever, something happens on a weekend or a holiday or in the evening, and they need to get it done right away. Mm-hmm. I mean, obviously, they can't sit around
right.
and wait to get a
yeah.
permit.
That type of thing's an emergency repair. You know, someone's furnace goes out, you know, Friday night. We're not going to make the people sit without heat until Monday morning when we open up and we can issue them a permit. Those are emergencies. The guy comes in, he fixes it. You know, Monday, they give us a call, hey, we're going to send in the check. We had to replace someone's furnace or hot water heater over the weekend. We're fine with that. You know, if it's an emergency repair, something that has to be done,
mm-hmm.
you know, toilet breaks in half, toilet's leaking terribly or whatever, we need to replace that now. Yeah, come and get your permit later.
Yeah. So what's the reasoning behind, say, a toilet and needing a permit for that?
I'm not sure on the exact history of where that came from, but I think it was misinstallation. And then also, I guess, related to the misinstallation is there's a state code that requires basically all plumbing to be done by master plumbers. And so with people doing their own work or maybe in a rental property doing their own work and doing it wrong, now you're taking away from a plumber's job that he should be doing. You know, toilet is a pretty easy replacement, but maybe not everyone has the mechanics as someone else, and they might not be able to do that correctly. And now they've got a leak. You know, now they're wasting water, or now they are putting sewage into their house, or whatever the case may be.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's the reason for that. There's a lot of permits, I think, that are minor, and they're out there. A lot of them are for record keeping. When in Oshkosh, long before I was here, I know required permits for a re-roof, but when I worked in the city of Menasha, they did not require re-roof permits, but we were having a lot of contractors come from out of state whenever we have a hailstorm. And now we had no record of when the roof was done, who did the roof. And so that was more of, let's protect the homeowners here.
Mm-hmm.
So let's get a permit for it. Then we know who did it. Now we know who's responsible. Otherwise, you know, it's the homeowner's responsibility to track that down.
Yeah. You know, a lot of this stuff, not a roof, but, you know, I think about a toilet, something like that, changing a thermostat from a non-programmable one to a programmable one seems silly. On the surface, I think, you know, to most people, even myself. But when you explain, and I think you've done an outstanding job, John, of explaining the whys and wherefores behind some of this stuff, it really does make sense. I mean, it everything does seem to be there for a reason. And the bottom line reason seems to be to protect our environment and protect the homeowner or the tenant or whoever may be in that facility, whether it's a single family home or a big apartment complex. It's for the protection of everyone and to not waste water.
Right. The codes were created. I mean, any code was pretty much created because there was a problem with something happening. If a problem happened, they're like, okay, let's make a code so that it doesn't happen again or try to prevent it from happening again.
Yeah, not just people in suits at the city saying, okay, let's pull out our theme paper here, and let's write down ways we can stick it to the citizens.
Right.
That
right.
wasn't what any of this came from.
All the codes are designed to protect everyone.
Right.
That's
right.
In the building, working in the building, living in the building, visiting the building. That's what those codes are there for.
Sure. And I know that years ago, you know, the inspection department really had it had a bad reputation. And I think we've seen in recent years that has changed a lot and for the better. Are there more things that you guys could do to get even a better reputation when it comes to inspections and building permits and things like that?
Well, we are trying every day to improve our process. We have comment cards out there. They can contact us at any time. We encourage people to contact us if there's some way you think we could do something better or make it easier for someone to do something. Definitely let us know. You know, we want to be user-friendly. I mean, we want to have people come to us to help them. I mean, we're not looking to get, like you said before, we're not out to get you. We're out to help you. You know, that's what we're here for. You know, people come in, and I think sometimes they're so worried about coming in here because they think they did something wrong already, and then they come in and they find out, boy, this process was really easy. You know, you guys really helped us out. That's what we want to do. We want to help you out. We want people to come. We want them to use us, you know. You know, we don't want the fire department to show up at your house because it's on fire. Come see us so that maybe we prevent that from happening.
Right. And I'll just give a personal example of this. We had a deck redone. And our contractor went by the city codes, but you guys had updated the city codes, and he didn't know it. So as a result, he was using codes that were maybe a month old or whatever. And when the inspector came through, when the work was done, because that's the whole point of getting a building permit, is so that someone can come through at the end and inspect to make sure it's done right, and it didn't quite meet the code. And so it had to be redone, not torn apart and rebuilt, just a few little aesthetic things here and there needed to be adjusted. And the, I believe it was Nicole.
There's Nicole on staff, yes.
Yep. I believe it was her who came out and just worked with us, and especially the contractor, since it had been a contractor who did the work, you know, was nice, was helpful, explained exactly what the new code said to be done, and everything was fine. I mean, she wasn't there with a shotgun ordering that something be done and done right that second. You know, you guys were very easy to work with, we found. And so, I mean, if that helps to allay anyone's concerns about the inspection service or working with the city, John is absolutely right. They're not out to get you. They're out to keep things safe. And
We're out to help you. You shouldn't be afraid of us. I mean,
we had a good experience with you guys.
That's great. That's good to hear.
I mean, it was disappointing to know that something had changed. And, you know, is there a way to let contractors know when codes change?
There is. And, you know, I had said before, codes get created or laws get created because there was a problem. And so just like it sounds like the problem you had, your contractor wasn't educated on the code change. The state implemented, I don't even know, probably 15 years ago, that contractors now have to have continuing education. So when a code changes, they're going to find out about it because it's part of their continuing education that's required by the state that they have to have every couple years, I think, is the code cycle. They will find out about the code change. They'll get mailings or emails from the state saying, here's a code change. They need to have that in order to pull building permits, in order to be a contractor in the state of Wisconsin. You have to have that credential. And so that, again, a code was created or a law was created because there was a problem. Contractors weren't keeping up with the codes. Well, how could we help that? Well, let's require them to have continued education. Now they'll have to come to class every year. We have a new code. The codes get changed, you know, not every year, but let's say they do get changed every year. They get updated on here's the new codes, and now they'll be building the new codes. So before there was no updates, so guys did the same things they did like we hear in the field. We've done this for 40 years. Well, the code changed 2 years ago. The code changed 10 years ago, whatever.
Yeah, and this was a real recent code change, too, that he just wasn't aware of. And so maybe he missed an email or something where something had changed. But so I'm glad to know that they're, you know, keeping people up to date on things. We're out of time. And we didn't get to half the stuff I wanted to talk about, but hopefully I didn't beat you up too badly, and you'll come back again.
No problem.
So, excellent. I just wanted to also add one more point on the rental inspection program, and I'm going to do this in about 20 seconds. There's a rental inspection advisory board that the city is trying to create. It needs how many members, John?
I can't be for sure. I want to say six members.
Six or seven, yeah. Something like that. But they don't have enough people who've applied to be on this board. So if you have any interest in that, please go to the city's website and make application for it. That's going to do it for us. Thanks to John, thanks to you, and thanks to the crew. We'll see you next time. Until then, take care. Keep your eye on us. We've got our eye on Oshkosh.